Good morning, everybody. Dear friends, my faculty colleagues, and the chief guest of the occasion, Sri Anoop Chaturvedi. Please welcome him with a big round of applause. It's a great pleasure for me, and I am overwhelmed today that I am welcoming one of my students whom I taught 20 years back. It's a huge feeling for any faculty, and I can understand all my faculty colleagues sitting here, that when this honor comes to you, you feel extremely blessed. So it's not that Anoop will say that I am privileged, it's me who is privileged today. I'm privileged that one of my students has occupied the highest position of India's corporate body, that is HP today. He is the country head of HP. And I remember when I contacted him 20 years since he passed out, and when he confirmed that, yes sir, I will come, because he was in Mumbai, but recently he has been Gurgaon. So I was trying to recollect the olden days, that 2000, how was Anoop, what he was doing. And those recollections are very important for a faculty, because you try to correlate, you try to find out the success parameters, you try to understand that in a cohort of 60 students whom you taught at that time, there are some of them who are very successful. And idea here is to see that what made them successful. So I was trying to recollect all those days, and I was talking to some of my friends also who taught Anoop, and one of them is here, Professor Ravi Agarwal also, who taught him. And I can recollect that one thing, because yesterday I was talking to all of you, Jack Welch, four C's, four E's, that is energy, energize, edge, and execute. And all four things, if I am correct, fit with Anoop's journey. I remember that during those student days, he was the one guy who was seen in the class regularly, but the better part was that he was seen outside the class in almost all events. He was emerging as a natural leader. Natural leader is one who is very proactive, who exploits a given opportunity, who will not hesitate to participate or take the lead. उसको किसी को बोलने की जरूरत नहीं है, यानी वो आप ये काम करोगे, वो खुद आके बोलता है कि मैडम ये फंक्शन हो रहा है, इसमें मैं कुछ कर सकता हूँ क्या? So I remember there was absolutely all events which BIMTEC used to organize during those days, and Anoop was almost everywhere as a leader. Right from industry visits, to musical events, to debate, almost everything. So, other than his academics, the edge what came to his personality was primarily because he learned the art of leading, he learned the art of execution, he learned the art of doings at that point in time. And that continued rigorously, so that in a very young age, he became the CEO. So kudos to you, congratulations to you, and apart from that, what I can find one differentiator, which again I talked yesterday in a tacit manner, but I want to make it very candid today, that one again a huge differentiator, what I saw in Anoop, is humility, humbleness, which is normally not a very abundant item in successful people. So, in his growing up journey, along with other colleagues and friends, so whenever a chance came to talk to him, or a chance came to meet him, I found Anoop remained the same. He's absolutely rooted, grounded, no air that I am the CEO. He is same Anoop what used to be 20 years ago, at least for people like us. That gives a big edge for all of you, that every success if it is accompanied with humility and humbleness, that makes the success very sweet, very lovely and astounding. With these words, once again, I would like to welcome Anup Chaturvedi on this occasion. They are the students of PGDM General and they have come here for 2 years, 1921 batch. They are from different streams. They are very excited. And I hope that Anup's journey, his address will make you exciting today. Thank you very much and wish you all the best. So may I invite Anup to please come with us.
Good morning to all of you. I have a small request, and the request is that when I move towards a particular direction, I would request you to look towards me so that we are always having an eye contact. So especially those people who are on this set, can I request you to twist your neck a little bit here? And when I move back to this side, I will request to this group of people to move your neck a little bit here. Just a little bit here. Just a little bit here. We just celebrated International Yoga Day, right? Just a little bit here. What we are trying to do and what we just accomplished is orientation. Right? And this is something which will differentiate all over in our life. It's how we orient. And I will go back to 20 years down the memory lane. And I'm so honored and privileged to have this opportunity to be present here and talking in front of those who taught me, who oriented me 20 years back. And trust me, it is such a beautiful gesture to be present here. And it is a little bit difficult as well because you are a little skeptical, right, about yourself. As one thing which has definitely grown in last 20 years is my weight. And I'm serious. And this is not only the weight in terms of physical weight, it is the mental weight, it is the weight of responsibilities, it is the weight of liabilities, it is the weight of authority, and it is the weight of leadership which has grown over a period of time. But what is most important is that I still feel that the 2 years that I got at that point of time, I think I didn't do that much justice. And the reason why I feel so is because as sir rightly said, I was definitely extremely excited about taking part in the extracurriculars and moving around and doing, being present in all the debates or whatever opportunities that I could guess, because that was my strength, that was my strong area. Where I possibly lagged a little bit was the other aspect, which is in the classroom with 100% focus. And most of the students in MBA invariably think that classrooms are only incidental. Trust me, they're not. It is by design. It is not by choice. It is by design. And when it is by design, it is important that each of the courses that you are learning, while you may have yourself decided that I want to do this, I want to be this, it is very important for you to understand that the entire course and the curriculum that you will be going through in the next 2 years will be of some help to you someday. When I started my career, I was very clear that I will go to sales or marketing. To be precise, I mean, that's how we call it, right? Sales looks a little downwards and marketing is a little upward. But important thing is that if you don't know about cost, you're gone. If you don't know about the cost structures, you're gone. If you're not able to do financial structuring of the deals, you're gone. If you do not understand about contract management, sorry, you're gone. Because somebody may give you a deal, you may win an opportunity, but at the end of the day, the legal terms will come and they will haunt you after 5 years, 10 years. And large corporations have failed because of wrong contracting. And you will learn about it over the next period of 2 years. So my request and humble request to all of you is that while the course curriculum at times seems, and I'm sorry, I'm taking liberty here, sir, to say a few things. While the course curriculum at times may look boring to you, trust me, it is not. Because each and every of those chapters are going to have a role to play in your life 2 years down the line, 5 years down the line, 10 years down the line, 20 years down the line. When we were doing MBA, we were all quite excited about the brand. And everybody wanted to go and do something related to the brand. Sorry, that opportunity doesn't come so often. That opportunity will not come so early. It will come after 10 years. 20 years. Once you understand what the brand stands for, a lot of our people wanted to get into, jump into Balenciaga. You have to understand and then you have to make sure that you keep aligning yourself to those numbers and be friendly with them, because you may not be directly touching a balance sheet even if you are in sales, marketing or in finance also, right? You may not be, you know, you may not be creating the balance sheet. But after 10 years, after 15 years, after 20 years, depending on your own individual growth plans, you will definitely be required to understand what is it that a finance guy did. Because at the end of the day, you are the someone who will be answerable to the board, to the market, to the shareholders, to the stakeholders. So, what I try to do today is that I try to look at your 2019 match. I wanted to think big. So, I try to create a roadmap for next few years, and most of us generally do not have a plan beyond. So, we know about current state. Fine, good, congratulations you have made to the business school. You have few of those 0.5 or 1% of the population of India who are going to be the business leaders of tomorrow. Very few people, right? Now, if you are the one, are you prepared? So, this is a rough sketch, a framework that I have created. You may agree to it, you may not agree to it on a few initiatives, on a few changes. So, my request to you is please make your own plan and think about entire life as a journey and define a few milestones and then try and see how will you take each and every initiative or each of the changes which are happening around. So first let's have a look at the fact that what is changing. Now what is changing right now is that almost everything, right? So 5 years back you used to study in a particular manner, 10 years back you used to study in a particular manner. But what is changing is almost everything other than the value system. Now, value system is a very vague word because most of us actually get swayed away by what is value system. Value system is what you as a person believe in, what Anup Chaturvedi will stand for, want to be known for, what you as XYZ would want to be known for. That is the value system. The value system is imbibed deep into your system. And since you are young and freshers, let me tell you, there will be opportunities, there will be influence, there will be cross-cultural influence on you, there will be internet's influence on you. Please make sure that you don't compromise to the value system, because this is what you will live for and this is what you should not die for, but you should evolve for. So let's have a look at what is happening around us. We are currently held captive by a sensitive touch. So 20 years back, as sir rightly said, those days mobiles were not there. Fortunately, we were really blessed that we didn't have mobiles. Now today, even while I am saying so, it's really difficult, right? I checked my WhatsApp 3 times. But one thing that I want to do away is to be controlling and taming this rather than being controlled by this. The strong urge to check messages, the strong urge to check the dynamic content is holding us captive. Today, Google knows, Facebook knows, and where I am, what am I doing, how am I shaping up. It's not bad. I don't say that it is bad. It's important to make sure that you control your digital footprint. And now there are specialized agencies which can help you to control, once you evolve as a business leader, they will help you to control your digital footprint. They would want you to be seen in a particular manner. So if you want to be seen in a particular manner, if you want to be yourself, if you want to make sure that people do not compromise on your ability to think, then it is important that you leave as minimal digital footprint as possible. And you should not be held captive by this, rather this should be held captive by you. The tools are there, the processes are there, all that you need is to make sure that you control this. So you use it when you want, rather than the mobile using you when you want. And somebody sent a beautiful WhatsApp message to me sometime back that human beings are hooked and machines are learning. Right? So we are hooked. And who's giving data? Us. Who's learning? The machines. So what is happening is that over a period of time, technology is becoming extremely, extremely important. Now whatever roles you will do finance, you will do accounts, you will do sales, you will do marketing, you will do branding. Trust me, without technology, So you have to be aligned to technology. You have to understand, and if not understand, then at least appreciate technology. Because technology will play a very, very important role in the future. The second big thing which is happening around us is intelligent assistance. And why I say intelligent assistance is because what is happening around us is a very interesting phenomenon. And I got one Alexa sometime back as a gift. Now there were two things happening in my house. One was a set of people who wanted to seek intelligent information. And we wanted to know what is the score, what is the weather in Delhi, okay, what is the weather in Mumbai, what is the weather in New York. And the other was a very dangerous trend because of which I shut down Alexa. And it was my 9-year-old daughter who was asking Alexa to compliment her. She's asking Alexa, Alexa, give me a compliment. Alexa tried first and gave her a nice compliment. After 1 second, she again asked, Alexa, give me one more compliment. Alexa gave one more compliment. Third time she said, Alexa, give me one more compliment. Now Alexa maybe could have got tired, right? If it is human beings, then after a certain point of time, to your sister or to your better half or to whoever is asking, you will give one compliment, two compliments, three compliments. After some time, you'll say, hey, come on, pagal again. Right? But machines have unlimited potential. But what was dangerous in this trend was our interaction with the internet, our interaction with the intelligent media, because Alexa was possibly learning that my daughter loves compliments. And I don't want Alexa to know that. I don't want Alexa to know that she wants compliments. I'm okay if Alexa knows that she wants to know about weather, she wants to know about war, she wants to know about riots, she wants to know about technology evolution, perfectly fine, but not about compliments. So that is what we need to watch out, because what is changing in a big way is that these intelligent assistants are voice enabled. Today, Alexa comes and supports almost around, I think, 14 or 15 Indian languages. What this means is also a terrific potential ahead of us, because in times to come, we will be using and leveraging technology like never before. And when we will be using it, watch out, because while we are delivering this lecture, let's say in English, okay, somewhere in a B town or in a C town, there are kids who are already interacting with Alexa, maybe not going to a formal education system, but they are preparing themselves that they can also learn the same thing. So if you do not use it, you are a loser. So make sure that these voice-enabled assistants know less about you and more about your inquisitiveness. So ask more questions to Alexa, which can help you in terms of, one, creating a digital footprint which will tell others in future that, wow, this guy is very amazing, right? He's very intelligent. 20 years back also, he was asking intelligent questions, right? That is what you want to enable intelligence. But the third important trend, and I use it with due responsibility, and I'm glad that I got this gift today, that a tree will be planted in my name. And this is one big thing which is not directly related to business, but will have a huge impact on the business environment and ecosystem around us. And that is insensitive greed. While we are very, very sensitive about what is happening around us, how we are using different interaction systems, what is difficult for us to understand is that insensitive greed, which means the strong urge to stay indoors, to stay in air-conditioned environments, to try and exploit nature to the best of possible and not be sensitive about it. So it's okay to exploit nature, because we are supposed to exploit somebody. So we have exploited our parents, we have exploited the society. I mean, right, come on. We are in business, right? A little bit of shrewdness is okay. But important thing is that are you giving back? And that's where most of the corporates today have CSRs in place, right? Corporate social responsibilities. So as an individual, you need to have an individual social responsibility, ISR. You need to make sure that what is it that you are giving back to the environment, because this insensitive greed, otherwise, will have a huge impact on you in future. So this is around us currently. Now, by the time you pass out, 2021, another 2 years, right? And this is my priority of things. You may have a slightly different priority of things, or maybe a completely different priority of things. That's perfectly okay, and you need to make your own stats. So three things which are happening, and there is a reason I used this term called adaptive cars. Most of the people know this as driverless cars, or they say automated vehicles, I say adaptive cars. And why I say adaptive cars is because these cars have to adapt to how we think and operate on roads. Now, when I say this, a Google may be easily able to drive the car in US, right? Wide roads, free roads, no problem. But in India, and that too in Delhi, and then in Noida. I mean, think about the challenges that Google has to learn, or I mean Tesla has to learn, or any adaptive car. They have to adapt to, one, the driving ecosystem, two, the behavioral ecosystem, three, the legal ecosystem, because if tomorrow there is an accident, who will get punished? The car, the driver, the guy who wrote the algorithm which will be driving the car, which will be deciding the decision system, the cameras which will be giving the feed, the speed radars, they are known as LIDARs, will they be held responsible because they gave a wrong input? Or the car's own running system, popularly known as engine, which earlier used to be a combustion engine, but it is no more a combustion engine as we are moving towards an electric car, right? So what is important is that these cars have to adapt themselves to a different set of rules, frameworks, technologies, possibilities, etc. What this presents for you is exponential possibilities in the next few years. So you can be supporting an adaptive car manufacturer by being a software, by working in a software company. Or you can be working with them with these adaptive cars in helping them understand how people operate or drive in Noida. Trust me, it's a skill, right? Or you may be helping these cars to understand more about how to handle a conflict or resolve a conflict. So adaptive cars will be the next big thing. Alternate energy. So fossil fuels are kind of dying, and there's a huge opportunity in terms of, one, how we harness energy, and then how we keep the energy, how we keep the energy reserves, which means that the entire battery size, if you see, if how many of you had a phone 10 years back? 5 years back? 5 years back, what was the size of the battery? Has it come down today? Today you ride your phone on a 2600 milliampere battery, right? Or maybe a little more. And use it whole day, 4 hours, 5 hours, 7 hours, just see. There is this small app which can help you understand that how many hours you will be moved on to the app, or the screen time as we call it popularly. You will be surprised, astonished the kind of battery that you are that is being supported, that is supporting your mobile ecosystems right now. So the battery ecosystem is evolving. Batteries are supposed to come down, shrink in size and store more energy, as we need more energy. When we need more energy and fossil fuels are dying, then it is important for us to align to alternate sources of renewable energy. I just used a pick which is solar energy, but it may not be solar. It may be something else. It may be wind energy, it may be kinetic energy of water waves that we may use from rivers, sea, ocean, etc., whatever. But alternate sources of energy is a huge potential. So you have to watch out for startups, companies which are doing work in these areas. And the third and the most important thing which is changing the world around us by 2021 is augmented reality. How many of you, has anyone been to Dubai? I mean, Sarkin obviously can tell us a lot about it. In Dubai, there is this place called Virtual Park, VR Park. Okay, and they really rip you apart. They charge a lot. But important thing is that once you get there, they get you hooked into a huge cable, and then you roam around freely into that VR park, and you can feel the fun of diving, okay, because if you're not that brave enough that you can go and jump from a building, then this is a real easy thing, because the moment you get scared, you just remove that glares and then you're fine, there's no problem with it. It's just a small swing which is taking you up and down. So most important thing is that on the entertainment side, we currently look at augmented reality, we watch movies by being present in the movie. What is going to change in the next 2 years is that augmented reality will be replacing a lot of jobs, which means a lot of assistants on the shop floor, a lot of assistants in the showrooms, in retail merchandise stores will not be required, because you will be able to check a lot of stuff. In fact, some of this has already started in a couple of places where they have got those huge mirrors, and you stand there and you can visualize yourself being dressed in a particular manner. Now, it is not only about being dressed because you want to buy this, let's say this jacket for the occasion of being present in Jaipur AIIMS Super Management. The right fitment of this jacket will be seen only if I see myself into an augmented reality setup with amongst you all. Okay, and see how many of you are okay with it. How many of you see, feel, what kind of color is it, right? So, yeah, at the end of the day, males are generally color blind. We are. Let's accept the fact. There are limited colors in our scheme of things. So, important thing is that augmented reality will change the way the entire retail ecosystem will work, the entire manufacturing ecosystem will work, the entire training and enablement side of it will work, and a lot more. So these are a few things which will change in the next 2 years. There are a lot more, but you can think more about them. These are the top three trends for me that I'm watching on. Now, 10 years down the line, this is very interesting because most of us think only about 2 years, right? But if you're in a career, you will be at a good position and you'll be doing really well for yourself 10 years from 2021. 2019 batch passes out in 2021. 2031 is very, very important because these are silent movements. Waves which are creating a huge amount of ripple effect, and these will be touching you in some way or other. Now, what is important is that man with or versus machine, as these 10 years are going to decide either we will survive with them or will survive against them. When it's against them, governments will take responsible actions to curb different ways of machine learning and maybe pass on regulations which will be helpful to humanity, etc., etc. But as an individual, you need to align to this because there are a lot of things which will be done by the machines. And hence, if you have a particular profession in mind, you need to check whether it will get impacted by 2031 or not, because it may. And if it is, then what role will you play? That will be a differentiator that you will have. And trust me, you will have to align your studies, your learning, etc. in line with whatever you want to do from 2031 perspective, because this will be one of the most important milestones for you. You either grow, this is like an inflection point, you either grow exponentially after 10 years or the career becomes stabilized, and this is where you create a huge impact on your career. Second important thing is technobiology, and this is my term. So why is it technobiology? Is because technology and biology are interesting in beautiful ways. How many of you come from a ZBC or a biology background? Let me tell you, you've got a great career ahead. And how many of you come from a technology background? Fantastic, you too have a great career ahead. But others who didn't raise their hands, let me tell you, you also have a great career ahead. And the reason for that is because these people will be working in these companies and helping you stay longer, live longer, be better, and use this technology in order to fix biological issues. And when I say biological issues, there is around, I don't remember the exact value, hence I'll not make a hazardous guess here, but there is some few tens of billions that Mr. Mark Zuckerberg has pledged in order to try and find ways and possibilities of living till 150 years. And people say, and there is a famous writer, in fact, I got this book from one of our professors only. His name is Yuval Noah Harari, and I strongly recommend all of you to read it. He says that by 2030, our lifespan will be around 150 years. Okay, it may be true, may not be true, but for sure we live more than 100 years. Now, if we live more than 100 years, we will have different problems to manage, right? First thing will be the teeth to be fixed. Correct? No dentures, tissue culture. And then AI enabled systems which will be looking at the body and trying to help you to be a better person so that you don't make mistakes like your predecessors. Right? So technobiology will be one emerging domain. From a business perspective, it will have a huge, huge impact because this means exponential opportunities for you to watch out for companies which are either related to technology. And when I say technology, it is not conventional technology, companies which are doing path-breaking work in the field of technology, which are trying to evolve and break their own demons, kill their own demons. These are the companies to watch out for, and tech companies which will be working in the field of life sciences. And the third and the important element is the smart cities. When I say smart cities, The cities where we live in are changing, transforming, evolving rapidly. What is also changing is that, and this is a very interesting example, because most of the development in the smart cities is not happening in the metros. It is happening in the tier 2 towns. It is happening in the tier 3 towns, because governments have realized that unless they actually do a load sharing between these urban population and the tier B towns or the tier C towns, they will not be able to grow beyond a certain level. And next where we have to watch out which are those cities, because these are the cities where employment opportunities will be there or business opportunities will be there. So we need to watch out for opportunities into these smarter cities, which will be making you better businessmen or will help you in getting a better job and maybe live in a better, smarter house in a smart society where lot of decisions like waste management, traffic management, transit management, etc. will be taken care of, and there is a lot of work happening. I will recommend you all to read about Smart Cities Vision of Government of India, and you will be thrilled to know that this is our government which is thinking about it. And you can, by the way, also contribute to a lot of ideas on PM Gov portal, and because you are all innovative, fresh out of colleges, so you can definitely think about how you can contribute to this. So that was 2031. Now let's look at 2051, which is real far off, right? I mean, you'll say where all you can go. 2050 is interesting because this is the time when everything would have changed. When I was in college 2002, and one of our friends walked up to me and he said, "Yaar, maloom hai agle saal tak Bluetooth headset aa jayega." And I was a technology student, I mean, I was a science grad, I was an electronics grad. I said, "Pagal hai kya? Bina tar ke chalega?" Trust me, this is what technology has, because Bluetooth was always in the labs. But in earlier days, the gestation period of a technology used to be 5 years, 10 years, with a lot of experimentation in the labs, and then finally it will be rolled out. Today? So if you are thinking about technology, if you are thinking about your own career, if you are thinking about what all you want to do, then you have to prepare, we have to be prepared in the 2051 mindset, as by 2051, a lot of things would have changed. And one thing which would have definitely changed is the first wave, which means a lot of people. Because population is growing, still growing at an unprecedented rate. And what it means, because it's not a philosophical lecture, but more of a business lecture, so hence, there is a problem, but let's look at the business potential. I'm sorry to say this, but let's look at the business potential. When there are so many people, that means the way we grow crops has to change, because we need to feed a larger population. Ways of storing this food has to change, because now we have to make sure that this food has to be stored for a longer duration. The ways we are looking at different ways of growing vegetables or tissue culture. In fact, there is something known as vegetarian meat, if you heard. How many of you heard about it? So there is an ethical dilemma obviously there. But what is it that the world is thinking is that by 2030 or 2015, if we have to evolve, then we need to make sure that proteins have to be there in the right side. Most of the guys will know it, right? And they generally look at protein. So it's important that how do we consume different vitamins, different minerals, different proteins, and hence the entire food industry will evolve. It's already evolving and it will evolve at a faster rate. We need to manage the problem of hunger by 2050. If we don't, then anyways, there will be huge repercussions of that. The second important problem is the pollution. So what you see is a sea of plastic. We just replaced the graphic of water with plastic, because this is what we are heading towards. And this is a strong cultural change that we want to bring in as a human being. Each one of us has to be responsible and has to make at least 5 people more responsible within the family or friends or circle, because this looks small, but this is a huge, huge, huge problem. But since we are in business and not in a philosophical lecture, it presents huge opportunities. Today morning I was served with a tea in a cooler. Somebody thought about making these coolers, right? and selling it to the institutions. Today, you go to a Chayos and you pay 110 rupees for the cup of tea in a cooler and you feel good about it. Now, what you are doing is obviously helping the environment, but on the business side, just think about the potential. If somebody said, let's make coolers more exciting, right? And somebody took that giant leap of faith in his business ideas and said that I will brand these coolers now and I will sell to all the big chains. And here you are, right? So think about alternate possibilities of business which will come your way, whether you want to do your own business or you want to work in corporations, organizations, which will be thinking on this. But in parallel, please do also think about how do we try and control it, because you are the guys who will be suffering the most. So you better watch out. The third important thing is the fight of being immortal. As by 2030, I said maybe our lifespan will increase. But 2050, either we will vanish, machines will take over if you stay hooked on. Or if you tame them, then we will be using them and we may become immortal. Now this is a huge debate whether we should be immortal, not immortal, because there is an element of God, and God knows, I mean, the moment Bombay becomes arrogant, 26th of July happens, right? And Gurgaon and Delhi, so I don't need to tell you, right? I mean, every time during the rainy season, you guys face it. So nature has its own way of giving us a lesson. But the important thing is that this immortality will also bring newer problems for us to address and newer solutions that we have to think of. Because by 2050, definitely this debate will be over whether we are immortal or not immortal, and who will have a better sense of existence. Is it machines or is it us human beings? But one thing which is very clear, while I scared you in the last slide, and if it is 2050, it is important to be scared a little bit, right? Because this all may go wrong, and if we control it, will not. But what will definitely emerge is a collective consent. When I say collective consent, each one of you is a huge data repository. How many of you have got Reliance Jio connections? Almost all, right? Why? Because it gives you free data. Right? I mean, free in the sense it is not free as in free, quote unquote, but it is really cheap to the extent of being free, right? So this data is like something which is driving you crazy. How much of data you are giving every day? Now, all this data, if it is being mined properly, if it is being managed properly, if it is being harvested properly, if it is being utilized properly, and if you are able to create those huge data marks which can help you to understand how we think, how we behave, what kind of diseases are emerging, what is happening around us, then trust me, we and machines together will be creating a huge ecosystem of collective conscience where we will be able to maybe implant you with a small silicon chip and you say, hey, your MBA is through, tomorrow go work, right? Or maybe we may just implant you with something wrong and say, hey, you've forgotten everything that you learned. But for sure, collective conscience is emerging in a very big way, and by 2051, it will be one huge collective information system for the whole planet. And this is my vision. It may be completely wrong because I also write at times something which is called as fiction. So you may choose a better version of this, but important thing is that movies like Avatar and a collective consent system for the whole planet do give an idea that if we are moving in that direction, this may happen. Second thing, as I said, is technology which will be controlled by us. Okay? Now this is the positive side of it. Which means that we will be able to tame the technology and use it in the way and the manner that we want. And what this basically means is, because technology is incomplete if your basic framework is not in place. Because, as we say, you give garbage to computers and they throw garbage back at you. So you need to understand, if you want to be in finance, if you want to be in sales, you need to understand what is it that is the input that you're giving to these machines. And for that, your theories in your classes are very, very important. Because 2050 will be the time, and this I'm saying by experience, when you say, yeah, us din agar class mein thoda dhyan diya hota na return of investment wale funde par, तो आज ये फाइनेंस वाला मुझे चला के नहीं जाता. Trust me, this will happen to all of you. And Ravi sir is present here. I really thank him and Pandey sir because I was not that good in the class. Trust me. But I was very good after the class, and hence I used to go and bother them after the class and trouble them in the canteen, etc. Because most of the times before the exams, I used to come and say, "Mujhe nahi samjha, please samjha dijiye." And they were really kind enough to help me. But the important thing is that had I been much more alert in the class, then possibly I would have troubled them less, and they would have maybe liked me more. No, they really liked me, but maybe a little more. We always die for more, right? If you get 3 GB data free. If you get one toothbrush plus one toothbrush free, we love free, right? And that's the reason people come out with 70% sale. It is not sale, come on. Just put the item in your cart and check the behavior and the price of the same stuff over a period of pre-sale and post-sale price. There will be hardly any difference, maybe 100, 200 rupees on an item of 1000 rupees. So controlled technology. But the third and the most important thing which will change is the captivating landscape of forest. Now we are re-looking at the way we will be doing afforestation, and this is very, very critical to our survival. And this also presents huge, huge opportunities if you want to be in real estate, if you want to be into the leasing business of real estate, if you want to be, if you will be taking some key decisions as the CEOs in times to come by 2050, or as head of different business units, as you will be taking decisions as to where your office will be. And most of these landscapes will be afforested, which means that the buildings will also be growing trees on the outside. This is a radical thought. By the way, this is already happening in few parts of the world, and this is catching up very, very fast. So, captivating urban forest. But important is, how will you measure the life? So this was about, it was like earlier days we used to have this program called The World This Week, right? So it used to summarize the whole week's happening. So I just tried to summarize and give you a small news bulletin of 2050 just now. But more important is that whatever will happen on the technology side, this is the important framework that you need to design for yourself and see how will you measure your life. So when we meet you in 2015, or when your profs meet you in 2015, this is what will be discussed. That how did you measure your life? Now what are the important things about your life? And a few mistakes that you should avoid. And thanks to Clayton and Christensen that he created this beautiful framework. The most important thing is that you need to have a strategy for your life. And when I say strategy for your life, please make sure that this strategy encompasses all the three important fields. First and the foremost is relationships. Let's understand when machines will come and disrupt the way we operate, the way we think, the way we behave. It is all about relationships in those times. Already in India, I remember, in fact, I can ask sir, 20 years, 30 years back, if someone came to a psychiatrist or a psychologist, they would say, "You're crazy. Looks like there is a disease." And one of those days when I was shuttling between 2-3 meetings, I decided to stay and spend some time in a coffee shop in Rajiv Chowk. And I realized that there was one lady besides me who was continuously talking. And then I realized that she was talking to different people, because she was conducting psychiatric sessions, okay, 30 minutes of people, and most of these people, and I'm sorry, I mean this is wrong because it's like breach of privacy, but I'm a keen observer, so I was just trying to overhear. The important thing was that most of these people had no problems. They just wanted to talk. They wanted to talk to someone. They wanted somebody who's a patient listener. So please make sure that your relationships come first and foremost in your strategy. Then comes your career. Then comes your health. And we will talk about it in a while. The second important thing is that with this strategy in mind, allocate your resources. As it is said time and again that you have limited resources. Now what are these resources? These resources are time. These resources are knowledge. So make sure that you don't waste your time, because as I said earlier, once we are hooked on to technology, it is very easy for us to waste time, right? Very, very easy. The same machines, the same appliances, the same handsets can be used for much more better things, which can help you to be better, brighter, sharper. So make sure that you allocate your resources wisely, which means time, money, and knowledge. These are the three important resources. The third is create a culture. Now, this is which is very, very important, but a very soft issue. ये बोलने से बताने से नहीं आता है, ये सिर्फ करने से आएगा. When I say culture, what is the culture that you are creating in your institute? Is it a culture of learning? Is it a culture of inquisitiveness? And this culture, please don't blame your professors, please don't blame the academicians, because each batch has a different cultural instinct. Each batch will be known over a period of time for a different culture. And this culture will be completely designed, architected, managed, operated by each one of you. So if you set a positive culture, if you set a negative culture and say, yaar, kuch nahi hota hai, naukri kaise lagega, wo Anup Chatterjee to bol ke gaya, 2030 mein waise bhi sab hone wala hai, kya fayda phir, let's chill, right? So please understand that positivity is very important and very rare. It is easier said than done. So create a culture of positivity. Create a culture of inquisitiveness. Ask questions. Don't be afraid. Don't think what my friends will think if I ask this question. You don't know this? Okay. Walk up to a friend who knows this. Walk up to a faculty who knows this. Don't be afraid. Don't be shy. Because this world, the world that you will be living in, and partly us also, because I am also counting on whatever Mark Zuckerberg is doing, and maybe I'll live for 50 years. So the world that we are living in will be changing, and it's important to have a culture, and culture is something which will happen over a period of time. It is not outright, so it is more of a mindset. If you guys decide today, we will have a culture of positivity, we will have a culture of inquisitiveness, we will have a culture of reading, learning, writing, then this culture is something which will shape you over a period of time. Yeah. The third important thing is avoid the marginal cost mistake. Now this is a, sorry, I borrowed it a couple of years back. I spoke to Pandey sir. And he asked me, where are you working? Sorry, I will play this reference. And sir used to teach us, other than being a life coach, he used to teach us economics as well. And one lecture where it used to be a household, we were always oversold. So he asked me a question, he said, where are you working? I said, Hewlett Packard Enterprise. And he said, yeah, last time when I asked you, you said it was HP only, right? I said, yes, sir. He said, "तो कितना साल हो गया तुमको?" I said, "Close to 13 years." He said, "I hope it is not a case of diminishing marginal utility." I remember it, sir. And I immediately revised. I said, "Yeah, diminishing marginal utility means that if you keep using the same thing over a period of time, then your utility drops." I said, "No, sir. So far it has been very good because I've been changing my roles. So one thing that worked for me." And by God's grace, I would want to be a CEO at some point of time. Right now, I am a country head for a particular business unit. And one thing which helped me over a period of time was that I tried to change my roles within the same organization. So whenever I was uncomfortable in a particular role, or I had already learned, I always created the next level plan. And I created next level of leadership. And one thing that I told all my people was that your job is to make sure that you replace me. Now this is a dangerous statement to make. And one of my friends who was working with me in my team, he said, but agar main aapko replace karunga to aap kya karoge? Wise question, right? Very wise question. I said, I am working to replace my boss. And a boss has to think about replacing his boss. Together we have to, as a company, we have to think about replacing our competition. And together as an industry, we have to think about replacing the existing set of offerings that we have in the market. And any one of us who does not do this in the cycle will be out of the life cycle. Will not work. There are a lot of companies which were into taxi business. Where are they? If you remember, and a couple of years back, it used to be a difficult thing to get a taxi in Bombay or in Delhi, right, from airport, and people used to charge atrocious money. And then came Meru. Have you heard about Meru?
Yes.
And we all said, wow, what a path-breaking thing, right? I mean, the driver will look clean, will look fresh, okay? He will not chew tobacco in the car, will be very professional. But what Meru didn't realize was that there was another set of competition which was coming from a technology company which will own no cars, Uber. And they changed the whole world. And God knows, Now Uber is being threatened by the existence of companies like BlaBlaCar. We'll say, why a driver? I am anyways going to Gurgaon, why don't you hop onto this ride? So you have to understand that the marginal cost is something which is that what errors will we make over a period of time. Which means that every time a company thinks that whatever is the sunk cost or the fixed cost, and sorry, I'm taking liberty here, sir can correct me because he knows what this is, right? Other than you, I can take this guess with you on the formula side. So marginal cost is the incremental cost. And I just linked it with mistakes, which means that whatever you have incurred in terms of your fixed cost, so whatever you learned over a period of time in last 10 years, these 2 years will be incremental learning. Same way, when you have a strong urge to watch a web series, the urge is only that marginal urge. You say, 15 minute dekh kar ke chhod dunga. 5 minute WhatsApp check karunga fir chhod dunga. Morning 4:30 you set a routine to go to the gym and you wake up at 4:30 and say, 1 minute WhatsApp check kar ke fir chala jaunga. It never happens. This is what you have to watch out, because this is marginal cost of making mistakes. When you will be in business, when you will be in your job, you will have a strong urge to do that. Itna chota sa karna hai sale, no problem. Kisi distributor ke paas dal dene maar. Don't do that, ever. Because this marginal cost of mistakes will come and haunt you after 10 years, after 15 years, after 20 years. Because the whole market, and for us, it was still okay because we didn't have a digital footprint. You have a digital footprint of whatever you're doing. The systems are much more sharper. So make sure that you don't get lured away by this marginal cost thing. And then the most important thing is what sir also said, remember the importance of humility. Whatever you are, you may look good, you may be very intelligent, you may be a very good reader, but don't forget or undermine others. And why I say this, I had a friend. This friend was, he's not doing so good in academics, okay? He was throughout consistent in his academics. And many of our batchmates, this is my, not my MBA days, but my college days, my graduation days, many of our friends discounted and said, ganda bachcha hai, kai bar parents bata dena, ganda bachcho ke saath nahi rehna, to ye ganda bachcha hai. But important thing is that if you stay humble, and that guy today is a very famous stand-up comedian. Because he was humble, he knew what he wanted to do. He may not have looked that good at that point of time, but he was working on his skill set, on his strengths over a period of time, and he was always humble. And people who were humble with him today can boast, he's my friend, I'll take you to your show. He will get a, you could, my son loves to get a selfie with him, others don't, right? So that's the power of humility. But the last and the most important thing is choose the right yardstick. And this is the most difficult thing for each one of you. So if I may ask you, and please raise your hands, how many of you feel that money is the most important thing? And please feel free, I'm not going to judge you. How many of you feel money is most important? I do feel, right? I mean, at the end of the day, we all live and die for increments. And we fight with our bosses. Good, so around 30% people feel that money is very important. How many of you feel power is very important? How many? So around 30-35% people feel power is very important. How many of you feel that learning is very important, because you want to be known? And learning means not learning. People knowing you as a great learner, saying he is a great learner. How many of you feel that that is a great thing? Another, oh good, this time we reach almost 35 to 40% almost. And how many of you think a great human being, being a great human being is the most important thing? Almost all of you. I am talking to a real nice batcher. Let me tell you. Once you enter into a corporate world, it may not be exactly like this, and I will get a photograph of yours and then come back to you. So this was the yardstick that you just said. And even if you have a difference of opinion, you feel that you raise your hand on money and not on being powerful, no problem. It's your own vision. Make sure that you, when you go back today, You write what is the yardstick of measurement for your life. What is the currency of your life? Right? What is the current? How many people, how many of you are watching World Cup right now? What is the currency of cricket? Runs? It's balls. Because each time a unit is changing, right? Each time there is a ball going, whether there is a run or not. That is the currency in which you say that this is where the match is going, because those 50 overs have to be bowled. Somebody will hit 150, somebody will hit 250, no matter. What is important is who won. India against Pakistan, India against Afghanistan. And we are the only team which has the mighty powers to make smallest of the team feel comfortable with us. And this is not from today. No. Long time back when we used to hear matches on shortwave radio, even in those days, most of the matches that we were hearing to, the wonder Indian cricket team used to beat Australia left, right and center. But the next very match, here comes Zimbabwe. And then you are praying, Hanumanji, Bhagwan Ram, somebody has to help, right? Or respective gods. So, important thing is that what is the currency of your life? How will you measure life over a period of time? Now, since we are in orientation, so I'll wind up with these few thoughts, which are my own thoughts around orientation, orchestration. And why I say orchestration is because, how many of you watch orchestra? So Bombay and all it is pretty famous. You have a huge set of people, around 40 people sitting, and there is one guy who is like directing like this. And at times you wonder, what is he doing like this? I mean, whether he knows how to play or he just does something like this and everybody does something. Because each of the instruments is being played according to the tones that this orchestration guy or the orchestrator, as popularly known, is telling them to play with. This is the tone, this is the bass, this is where we will have this tune. So today is the day of orientation, and I want you to orchestrate your career, your well-being, your physical, mental and virtual well-being. And please always remember these three things. I mean, the third being also very important, your virtual well-being, because this will differentiate you. So please be the orchestrator of your well-being. And how do you do that? The first is stay creative. And this is very easy. And don't get bogged down by the word creative, because at times by creative you feel art banana hoga baith ke. No. Creative means whenever you are in a problem or whenever you are being faced with a challenge, please think about alternates possible. You may not use them, but always think about alternates. There is another philosophy of saying that don't think about alternates, which is a different school of thought. I feel that you should always think about alternates and be creative. You may not use them, but think about alternates. Be creative. And most of the organizations, whether it is their own internal structures or their GTMs, go to markets, they are being very, very creative. Huge companies like ours decided to go completely offline, okay, from a few countries. So we are present in 178 countries. Sorry, I said offline. Decided to go online. So from 178 countries, we consolidated our operations and we said that we will now be present only in 40 countries. Remaining 140 countries, we will sell only through online portals. Now this is a huge shift, right? Why? Because we are being creative in terms of our GTM strategy. What it has an impact on is the organization strategy, right? So stay creative, create an impact, whatever you are doing. Whether you are being present in the class, whether you are doing your lessons, whether you are solving a case study, whether you are talking to people, whether you are talking to corporates which come during the course of next 2 years and have an interaction with them, please make sure that you have an impact. Now when I come here, I want to create an impact. And the impact is generally being measured in terms of how do you stay connected. I mean, it basically depends on the number of nods you get, number of smiles you get, number of Twitter followers you get, blah, blah, blah. So important thing is that think about creating an impact in everything that you do. But the third one is most important, that whatever failures that you had in life, and you will have, and everybody will have, you would have had quite a few and you will have quite a few. Make sure that you create a museum of those failures. Don't run away from those failures. Don't say this was not me. This is very much you. Remember, this is very much you. So create a museum of that and make sure that you preserve them in a museum so that you can keep looking back at them, because these failures had an impact on you. Stay true. As I said, avoid the cost of marginal mistakes. So stay true to yourself. Don't try and bluff yourself. Don't say, because of this, this thing don't happen, didn't happen. Say, because of me, this thing didn't happen. When you come late for a meeting, don't say, because Google Maps moved up. No. You could have started 30 minutes before. Make sure that you are true to yourself. Make sure you are true to the company. You are true to your bosses, because one thing that in a longer period of time doesn't do well is talking lies, speaking a lie. So don't say lie. You can manipulate at times, or I will not use the word manipulation. You may represent a few facts in a particular manner which is a little more convenient for you. But don't speak a lie. Don't fudge figures. Don't speak a lie. So stay true. This is most important. Stay fit. Iska importance abhi pata nahi chalega. Right now you're young, you can eat anything, right? I don't know. In Delhi, do you eat Frankies? In Bombay, Frankie ka bada fashion hai. Donuts, Frankies, lot of junk food, right? Stay fit. Don't fall prey to it, because this will have a huge impact on you when you will turn 40. Or when you will turn 30. Or you will turn 50. Yeah, I am speaking from my own experience. I used to be 104 kgs. Okay? And then one fine day, one of my friends got a heart attack in the office, collapsed. And my eyes opened. I immediately started running. Somebody told me, he said, you are 104. Imagine what will happen to your knee. And I said, whether I get a heart bypass or a knee replacement. While unfortunately, and this is a fact, is that you will be surprised to know that a knee replacement cost is much higher than the heart bypass. Maybe doctors are doing it so often. But the important thing is, I can take a risk with my knee, but I can't take a risk with my heart for sure. So stay fit and get this deeply embedded into your operating systems right now. Stay fit. This cannot be replaced. You can maybe make more money, you can do whatever good about yourself, but if you are not fit, you may have millions of dollars at a point of time. After 20 years, 30 years, you may have Sophia, which is the first human robot. 5 or 6 of them cleaning your utensils in the house. But if you are not fit, sorry. So please make sure that you stay fit and please stay innovative. Because this era does not belong to conventional things. This belongs to innovative things. And there is a difference between creativity and innovation. Creativity is about doing the same thing in a better way. And innovation is about doing something which is completely changed, which is completely new model of business. So stay creative, stay fit, and stay innovative. That was me, Anup Chaturvedi, for all of you. Signing off. Thanks for your time and being patient.
Another key observation was that, you know, it was very much in sync with what we are talking to the students since yesterday. So I'm sure students can relate to. These are the points that we also raised. And so you very beautifully started your session with highlighting certain trends. There were also certain apprehensions, fear, which is important for us to know. Then you talked about, you know, how they can be, they are all an opportunity or opportunities in disguise. So how can students look with hope and positivity on how to convert these fears or trends or take stride and convert them into opportunities. And you ended the session beautifully with how to strategize, prioritize, use resources wisely, and have the right yardstick to measure your performance and your success. So it was a very beautifully captured session, and of course we also advise students to take fun in challenging technology, because when you challenge technology, do get, he very rightly pointed out, let it not drive you. You are the ones who create machines. So all those Avengers and Resident Evil are not far from becoming realities if we are not cautious enough, if we don't learn how to control that technology. So one small personal experience that I had, when Google Map, I started it very, very late, maybe a year back. And intentionally I started late because it sort of blocks your mind. If you are so, you know, if you start using virtual guidance for each and everything, it's not good for your brain. But I was sort of compelled to do that, because whenever you travel to Jaipur or any other location which you're not very aware of, there's nobody who can guide you now these days. So you ask, earlier days if you ask anybody, everybody sort of knew directions. Now you ask anybody, nobody knows direction. And when you ask the person you are going to, would come back sending you a Google Map location. So I was forced to do that. But one day I challenged Google. It was directing me on a route saying that this particular route is very, very busy. So I should take this route. And I was not very comfortable with that. So I decided to take this route. And I found that it was all wrong. It was a freeway. So and I was discussing with some of my colleagues that is Google now trying to manage traffic? So it was guiding us, but now it's sort of trying to divert and manage on its own. So it is actually trying to take control of yourself. The cameras that you have on your phones, the selfie cameras, the back, at 24 hours it's capturing your images. Digital footprint you talked about. So whatever you do, whatever you're browsing, all that data is actually going with somebody who can use it to come back and blackmail you maybe one day. Right, so Google has total control of our entire country's demographics and, you know, the geographical location. And if it, I was just sharing with somebody, one day Google decides this country can come to a halt. Because all traffic, it will divert to a place where you come to a jam lock situation. So they are all real fears. So you need to be aware of all this, and you need to have your action point in place. We talked about certificate programs yesterday. You see the importance of it. So just 2 days playing vanilla MBA course will not help you. You need to move and you need to continuously learn. So one action point that I can think of is please continuously learn, keep tab on the latest trends in the economy, market, technology, and keep moving forward. So with this session, with this sir, I really thank you a lot for taking time out and speaking to our students. We look forward to many such talks from you in the future. Thank you so much. Thank you.
My gratitude to our Honorable Chief Guest for sparing his valuable time and sharing his immense knowledge with us. We hope this association of ours continues and strengthens in the times to come. With these inspiring thoughts, I am sure the students are filled with zeal and fervor